Welcome to the Meaning Explorers podcast. This is Fredrik Strang. So in this episode, I'm thrilled to take you on a roller coaster journey to some of the most mythical climbing spots in the world, as I invite renowned alpine climber Colin Haley in a genuine discourse about the obsession of climbing, risk versus reward, addictions, losses, and trying to dissect what the final frontier for alpinism entails. Colin Haley is an American alpinist known for fast and first ascents of technical demanding routes on mountains around the world, and in particular the Alaska Range in Patagonia. Haley is perhaps best recognized for his traverse of the Taurus, first with Rinaldo Garibotti in 2008, and subsequently with Alex Honnold, this time completing the traverse under 24 hours. I first met Colin when I was climbing a new route on Alpa Mayo back in 2002. Colin was then 17 years old. He climbed the Ferrari route on Alpa Mayo, and I remember him as a kid full of ideas, ambition, and full of dreams of pushing the boundaries of alpinism. If you ever follow his Instagram feed, then he is this unmistakable guy with the funny duct-taped shades on his glasses, taking selfies on daunting spots as he ventures up alone on desolate, formidable walls. Colin skipped his high school graduation in order to make his first trip to Denali back in 2003. And when friends graduate becoming authorized mountain guides, he sends his condolences. He holds the speed record on three of the grandest faces of the Central Alaskan Range. South face of Denali, 8 hours, 7 minutes. North face of Barrigoya, 7 hours, 47 minutes, and south face of Sultana, 12 hours, 29 minutes. I'm curious to learn what outlook a person who lived life on the edge has on the world. If living a fulfilling life instead of counting the years is more sought after, and what the future of alpinism holds. So without further delay, I bring you Colin Haley. So I'm sitting here with Colin Haley in your apartment. Thank you for bringing me to your apartment and welcome on the podcast.
Tack.
That was Swedish for thank you. You know some couple of words in Swedish.
A few, yeah.
Yeah.
Mostly just important things like hey, snigin, snigrumpa.
I'm not sure whether or not I should parental advice here if I should translate that, but the first part is hello.
Hottie.
Yeah, hottie. That's a good word. So before we dig into your impressive track record, first ascents, free soloing, realizing one's dreams, close calls, epiphany, and other interesting stories. Please tell the listeners a little bit about yourself and your background.
Let's see. I am 35 years old, and I grew up in Seattle, which is in the northwest corner of the U.S. And I grew up doing lots of things outdoors. I was skiing since before I can remember and hiking since before I can remember. And my father was not a serious climber, but he did a decent amount of kind of classic mountaineering in the Cascade Mountains near Seattle, and he climbed Denali in 1980, stuff like that. And when I was about 9 or 10 years old, he started taking my brother and I out mountain climbing, but very occasionally, like once or twice a year. And because for him, it was kind of like a hobby he did now and then, and mostly he was into windsurfing. But for whatever reason, I became really, really into it. My brother kind of liked it, but I just became obsessed with climbing mountains.
But windsurfing, not so much.
No, I tried it a few times and it didn't really
never
speak to me that much. Yeah. Basically, since I was about 14 years old, I would say, so for the last 21 years, climbing mountains has been the overwhelming focus of my life. Mm. And now I'm making my home base mostly here in Chamonix, just because I think there's nowhere else in the world where you have such good access to alpine terrain. So it's kind of the ultimate place to be to train for bigger mountains elsewhere.
We're sitting in your apartment, and let's give the listeners a little understanding what we see around here. It better if you perhaps describe.
Okay. So, yeah, I bought this apartment about a year and a half ago. It's 28 square meters, so it's relatively small. And it's partially underground, and it faces north, and it didn't come with a cave or a garage or a parking space. But all those things made it the perfect choice for me, because Chamonix is a fairly expensive place, and it was a place I could actually afford. And for me, I spend most of my time outdoors anyways, so I don't really care if I have a nice apartment. Most of the time, it's just for sleeping and eating dinner. And because it's so small and because I have so much climbing and skiing gear, I had to be quite crafty with where to put everything. And I did a bunch of renovation right after buying it, and so I kind of treated the apartment a little bit like a ship, you know, where everything has a little nook and cranny and every bit of space is used as efficiently as possible. So I built lots of shelves, and, you know, the bed opens up, and inside are all my down sleeping bags and things like that.
But I'm still confused and perplexed because
you don't see that.
I don't see the gear.
Yeah.
Is it hidden behind the walls?
No. I guess like 6 months ago, I succeeded in buying a cave, like a cellar, which is just down the hallway on this same level.
Which explains it.
Yeah. So I have a lot, most everything that doesn't need to be kept, you know, as dry as possible. Everything, all my clothes and sleeping bags and stuff like that are in the apartment. But then skis, crampons, carabiners, cams, you know, all that stuff is in the cave.
Savvy.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Good. Well, you're best known for your solo and speed climbs around the world and have an impressive list of first ascents. But before we digest in some of your most memorable and proudest climbs, let us inspect the art of soloing. I'm certain many listeners have heard that Alex Honnold started soloing because he was too shy to ask people to climb with him. But how did you get into soloing?
I think I originally got into soloing not as true soloing, but as simul soloing. A lot of my mentors climbing in the Cascade Mountains near Seattle would go out in groups of 2 to 5 people and go climb an easy route, but everyone climbing it unroped as kind of like a big party. And probably that has somewhat to do with the nature of the Cascade Mountains, in that the approaches are generally quite long. You know, here in Chamonix is nothing by comparison. And a lot of, there are some hard routes here and there, but it's largely kind of like classic ridges with climbing up to 5'7" or something like that, which is probably French grade 5. Often there's an easier way down the other side of the mountain. So the long approaches and often moderate climbing kind of lends itself to going out and climbing without ropes, because, you know, when you're taking 2 60-meter ropes and a double set of cams and all that, and the approach takes a full day and then the climb is only 6 pitches, then, you know, it's a lot of hard work on the walking for what you get out of it. So anyways, we did lots of simul soloing, which to this day I would still say is probably the most fun kind of climbing, in my opinion, out with a few friends chatting the whole time, because you get the camaraderie of climbing with friends, but you also get the freedom of climbing unroped, which is always so much simpler, so much lighter, so much faster. So it's kind of this the best of both worlds to some degree. So that's how I originally got into climbing unroped. And I still love simul soloing when I go out with the right friend for the right objective. But bit by bit, I started experimenting with real soloing by yourself and on routes that are hard enough that it's kind of an intense psychological experience and a very serious endeavor. Because for me, if I go out and solo the Erecta Cosmique, to me, that doesn't really feel, it's not really what I would call like a solo that's meaningful, because the climbing is so easy for me that if I went there with a friend, I wouldn't want to use the rope anyways. And it's kind of more just for the joy of moving over terrain. Whereas if I go to solo something that's difficult enough that I know I have to, you know, really be careful and do everything I can to, you know, make sure I don't fall, and it feels kind of scarier, that's like a different activity from the kind of casual soloing.
Is that more meaningful?
Well, yeah, it's an experience that is much more memorable, that's for sure.
The north face of Greybeard Peak and the north ridge of Mount Stewart was one of your earliest solo climbs. Was that like a new universe opening up to you?
Yeah, those are two climbs in the Cascades that were kind of like my first hard solos, I would say. I don't know if it was a new universe, but it was my first experiments in this realm of climbing that is hard soloing. And I've done a lot since then. And it's a type of climbing that, you know, I think appeals to some people and not at all to other people. And that was kind of the introduction to hard soloing for me.
I once heard a person say, climbing grade French 5, pretty much anyone can climb. Grade 6, you need some technique and some agility. Grade 7, for that you need to train 3 times a week or so and also think about your body composition. Grade 8, you need to befriend with the guy with the white beard in the sky. In grade 9, you would need to befriend with the diabolic guy down below. What I'm wondering here is, which level are you climbing solo? And secondly, how close to your limit are you when you're soloing?
Let's see. I think I have probably very, very rarely free solo anything harder than about 6A. And in sport climbing, I've done a few red points of routes that are given, according to some people, 8A plus, and according to other people, 8B. So my free soloing limit is about 2 full French numbers below my red point limit. And to me, that's a very large margin, but that's basically what is acceptable to me. I have known lots of other people who free solo drastically closer to their actual red point level than I would ever consider doing. I've done lots of soloing that's much harder than 6A, but then you start to use a rope. I think because of the fact that I've done lots of soloing and just because of the nature of doing hard technical alpine climbing, I think a lot of people assume that I take lots of big risks and stuff. I actually consider myself a very cautious climber. And I think it's far more common that when I go climbing with someone new that I'm the more conservative person than they are in terms of building anchors and thinking about rockfall and all that sort of stuff. So I consider myself a quite conservative climber in lots of ways. And one of them is that I keep my free soloing level far, far below my actual rock climbing ability level.
I think there's a metaphor, an old climber is a wise climber. You seem to be very cautious and you pay a lot of attention to the safety margins. And I'm wondering, with this margin that you have, does it feel like you're almost bicycling when you're climbing and free soloing 6A?
Well, I think a lot of the time, yeah. But even at like two full French numbers below my red point level, by the time it gets to be 6A, I'm already being extremely slow and cautious in my climbing. You know, the same pitch, if I was climbing with a rope, I would just be kind of dancing up there, putting in a few pieces of protection really quickly. But if I'm climbing without a rope, I take it much slower, much more precisely, test all the holds much more. So even at 6A, I wouldn't say that it really feels like just out on a bicycle, because I just think it's like you have to always remind yourself of what are the consequences of falling. And even if physically the moves are super easy for you, you have to not get complacent and start being, you know, kind of careless about it.
So the mythology, I'm trying to picture myself how you pursue this skill. Is it like check, double check, trouble check every hold? Because some of the grips and some of the rocks could be potentially loose unless you haven't checked them beforehand.
Well, for sure. I mean, if you're free soloing, I think you would be wise to always check, you know, how sound the holds are, far more than you would normally. But I think it's also that if you are climbing well, well below your actual physical free climbing abilities, then most of the time you're never completely reliant on one hold. And if you do rip a handhold off and you have two footholds and another handhold, you're probably going to be just fine. Whereas if you rip a handhold off, but you're climbing, you know, closer to your actual physical ability, then that's it.
The risk for a random person doing what you're doing is exceedingly bigger than if you do it, because one should maintain that you, with all your experience, somewhat have mastered the skill. But the consequence of a fall for either you or the amateur is the same. Both will die. How do you navigate through the realm of risk and consequence, and how do you justify the solo climbs?
Well, I mean, I think that the question of acceptable risk is not really any different for climbing by yourself versus climbing with a partner, because all climbing does involve at least some risk. And, you know, people like to say, oh, this person does solo climbing and these people don't do solo climbing. In reality, almost every climber does some solo climbing, because even if you go and climb on the south face of Brévent, on the approach, it's just scrambling, but there are plenty of places on that approach where no one ever ropes up. But if you were to fall, it's fairly likely you would die. And so even though it's basically almost hiking, that should still be considered soloing to some degree. And so everyone almost does some level of climbing where the consequence of a fall might be death. So, you know, that whole balance of having to be as careful as necessary, but also accepting that there's consequences to that mistake, exists for everyone. And in the case of someone like myself, who does a fair amount of more difficult solo climbing, you know, that's more obvious. And of course, a greater percentage of my total climbing has the consequence of death to a fall. But it's something that really anyone who's done much climbing is familiar with, I think.
Are solo climbers adrenaline junkies? Or is this one of the biggest misconceptions among people in general?
There might be some who are adrenaline junkies, but if there are, I don't think there are many. But I think that can be said about climbers in general. I mean, the reality is that climbing isn't really an adrenaline sport at all. Skiing is, downhill mountain biking is. I mean, those are adrenaline sports. But climbing is, by comparison, a relatively slow activity. You know, everything is done very methodically. And so, I think most climbers don't feel adrenaline when they're climbing. Or if they do feel adrenaline, it's because something is going terribly wrong, and which is like a very rare instance.
So if you can rewind the clock and go back when you were 15 and you could see your life unfold, would you think your 15-year-old guy, your 15-year-old person would be surprised about what you accomplished?
Yeah, I think, probably.
Scared?
Well, I've had some close calls, so I guess if you could anticipate those close calls from before, I don't know, it's an odd thing to try and wrap your head around. I guess if you know that you're going to have a close call in the future, but you also know that you won't actually get hurt.
So what?
I guess if you know that you've come out okay, then there's no reason to be scared. But it's obviously a very hypothetical
question. It is, indeed. There are several things that attract you to hard soloing, and you're perfectionist of nature, detail-oriented, and that seems to favor you. You say, quote, "Some climbers manage to get up hard climbs by just throwing some stuff in a backpack, heading out, figuring it out as they go along, in a sort of whatever, it's all good mentality. Or at the very least, they present it that way. By contrast, your climbing involves a lot of thinking, analysis, little detail to maximize efficiency and safety. If you couldn't tell anybody about your solo climbs, post or publish anything about your endeavors, would you still perform these hard solo climbs?"
Yeah, that's an interesting question, that if it was totally secret, would you still do it? And I guess I would phrase the hypothetical situation slightly differently, only because this is a concept that I was thinking about not that long ago, and I was having a conversation about this with Alex Honnold, actually. And the hypothetical scenario that we were imagining was, say you woke up tomorrow here in Chamonix and all the other humans had disappeared, and you somehow knew that there were no other humans on Earth anywhere. You were the last human on Earth, but you were here in Chamonix. There was all the climbing gear you could ever want just down the street in Snell Sports, but there's no other humans at all. Would you still go out and try to, you know, solo the North Face of the Drew or the Walker Spur and things like that? And, or in Alex's case, you know, would he still go and try to solo El Cap? And I think it's quite common in climbing that people like to claim that they feel zero competitiveness, which I usually think is bullshit. Both Alex and I said that we thought we probably, under that hypothetical scenario, wouldn't pursue really hard climbing, but we would still go out and kind of solo easy routes where it's easy enough that it just is like the joy of moving over terrain and that kind of flow. And what that means is that if there's no one else around and you no longer pursue really difficult climbs, then obviously that means that there's something about, you know, our interactions with other humans and being part of a culture and a community that makes us want to pursue something that's really difficult. And I think that's probably true for tons of things, not just climbing. But to me, that's not a bad thing. And I think it's human nature to have some desire to like excel and compare ourselves to one another. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I just, when I hear people say that, like, oh, no, I would never, like, you know, have any sort of competitive thoughts in climbing or something like that, I think it's usually not true. I think it's human nature to compare ourselves to one another, and I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing, as long as you're a nice person and honest about what you do. And just because you have a competitive thought or a competitive feeling doesn't mean that you act like a competitive jerk, you know. Mm. But I do think that if there were no other humans on Earth, I wouldn't go try and solo Tor Heyerdahl, but I would still go do things like the Arete Cosmique, because at that level of difficulty is just so fun. In the kind of more primal joy of just like moving through terrain. I think there's kind of some innate human desire, well, not just human, animal desire to just kind of explore. And, you know, when you go out and do easy soloing, it's kind of satisfying that urge to just go move through the mountains, which you can also get just going, you know, exploring through the forest and stuff like that.
So if you weren't a hard soloist, forests or perhaps even windsurfing would be the perfect substitute.
I'm sure if I wasn't into climbing, I would be probably very obsessed with some other activity. Yeah. If tomorrow all humans disappeared from the earth except for Adam Andra, would he still, you know, train like a fiend to climb another 9C? I don't think so. I think there is something about being part of the human community that makes us driven to do exceptional things. And in the absence of other humans, it's not really exceptional anymore. And I think that there wouldn't be that desire to push yourself in that way.
What is the beauty with soloing?
Well, I think in my mind, the beauty in soloing is that you are reliant upon no one other than yourself. And, you know, to say that I want to get to the top of that mountain and I want to do it completely by myself and I won't have anyone there to help me, anyone to provide moral support. It's just very challenging and it feels like a quest, I guess. You know, I think normally when you climb with a partner, and to be clear, you know, I don't want people to have the impression that I'm only about soloing. I would actually say that I usually, well, not only usually, the vast majority of the time prefer climbing with a partner. But, when you're climbing with a partner, you know, it's basically a team sport then. And, how well you and your partner succeed on a climb or fail on a climb is dependent upon you and that person. And when you're soloing, it's not a team sport. And there's just kind of inherent differences in the feeling you get accomplishing something when you did it completely by yourself.
And just to remind the listeners, the vast majority of your pictures on Instagram is climbing with other people and roped up.
Yeah, yeah, of course. I for me, soloing is kind of it's something that I like because it's such an intense experience and it's so immensely challenging. Like the same route with a partner feels so easy compared to by yourself. But most of the time, I definitely prefer climbing with a partner. You can do far harder climbing. It's more fun being with a friend. So soloing is one aspect of my climbing ambitions.
There's noticeably big difference between soloing a route on site versus soloing a route you have already climbed before. One would be bigger on the adventure scale, and one would be bigger on the sports scale. Quote, sometimes alpine climbing is all about the adventure, and sometimes it's all about the sport, and usually it's partly about both. So I'm asking, perhaps we already covered this, but does one style attract you more than the other?
Yeah, I mean, so that's a quote I wrote kind of reflecting on my solo of the Infinite Spur in Alaska. But I think the concept is true of all mountaineering, that it is a combination of sport, like athletics, and adventure, exploration. And it's definitely not all one or all the other, because, Yeah, it's physically challenging, and that makes it athletic, but it's extremely different from running 100 meters on a track, obviously. And for me, the fact that climbing mountains is both an adventure and a sport is really probably one of the most concise ways to describe why I like climbing mountains. For instance, if you are into sailing and you sail around the world by yourself in a sailboat, that would be extremely adventurous, or at least it was before GPS and satellite phones, but physically pretty easy. You just tighten some ropes now and then and you hold the rudder, you know? That's not really athletic at all, but it's extremely adventurous. And at the other end of the scale, you have people running the 100 meter dash in the Olympics, which I would say involves essentially zero adventure, but extremely high athleticism. And I think if climbing mountains was only one or only the other, it would not be that interesting to me. But the fact that climbing mountains is very demanding of your body and your mind is exactly why I like it. I think it's the combination of those two things that makes it such an engrossing activity. You know, where you finish a big day of climbing and physically you're completely destroyed.
Both mentally and physically.
Well, you're physically destroyed, but also making that ascent happen over the course of that day is completely dependent upon, you know, a huge wealth of experience and all these things that you keep in your head about tactics and how to protect it and so many little details.
How important is it to reach the summit versus climbing a beautiful line?
Well, they're not mutually exclusive. So it's not like you either climb a beautiful line or you go to the summit. Hopefully you do both. I guess I wouldn't say that either one is important. I think what is important is being honest and accurate about what you do. And I've probably earned somewhat of a reputation, at least in North America, for being very strict about going to the summit. And it's not that I think everyone should go to the summit. People should do whatever they want. But I think it's important that people recognize that going all the way to the top of the mountain is always more difficult than going partway up the mountain and then retreating. And, you know, here in Chamonix, there are so many climbs here that are in the mountains, but they're not really mountaineering because you kind of just ski to the base of one mountain and then you climb six pitches and then you just rappel back down with half the mountain still above you and then you ski down. And so here in Chamonix, so much of the climbing that people do in the mountains doesn't involve going to the summit. And so I think it's easy for people to start being like, okay, summits, whatever, it's not even part of it. But for me, climbing here in Chamonix is basically just training for the real thing, which is in other mountain ranges. And yeah, it doesn't matter if you just climbed a whole bunch of pitches of grade 6 ice and 7B plus rock, and from you to the summit is just low angle snow slopes, to be like, oh, well, the climbing we already did is so much harder that this is just too easy for me. I'll just go down here. I mean, that's total bullshit. You know, it's never too easy for you. You're too tired. You're not motivated enough. You climbed too slowly, so the weather's getting bad. There's always a real reason why people don't go to the summit. And so I'm not telling people that they should go to the summit. People should do whatever they want. But when people don't make it to the top of the mountain, they should be very clear and forthright about that. You know, you shouldn't have to ask someone after they report climbing a route, oh, wait, did you go to the top of the mountain? You should already know, because there's always a difference. And maybe in some cases, it's a small difference. But in a lot of cases, it's a very big difference, even if the terrain above you is far easier technically than the terrain you've already climbed.
Here are some top few climbs according to your choice. We're going to cover some of them. And I think top of your list is Sultana, the Infinite Spur. That was the first solo ascent of the route and speed record. That was 12 hours, 29 minutes, Bergschrund to summit back in 2016. Then Torre Eger and Punta Heron, Charlton Massif. And you made a first solo ascent of both peaks the same year. And Bergøya, Central Alaska Range, third place, the North Buttress, first solo ascent of the north side of Bergøya, speed record of 7 hours 46 minutes, Bergschrund to summit back in 2017. Let's start with Infinite Spur in Alaska. And you asked yourself, and this is a quote, why hasn't the Infinite Spur been soloed? You concluded then that it was already well past the date at which a solo of the Infinite Spur would have been equally impressive in the context of its era to Porter's solo of the Cassin. And for the record, soloing the Cassin has become a sort of a cult classic climb among elite North American alpine climbers since Porter's incredible first solo ascent. How did Infinite Spur become a goal of yours?
I think basically just because of those thoughts that are kind of outlined in that quote, that the Central Alaska Range is relatively easy to get to from Seattle, because most flights to Alaska pass through Seattle. So from Seattle, you take a 3-hour flight and you're in Alaska. And the Central Alaska Range is on the same scale as anything in the Himalaya. So it's very big, very cold, very snowy, very serious mountains. And so if you are from Seattle, it's kind of the obvious place to go test yourself in big, serious mountains. And the Infinite Spur is one of the most mythic routes in that range. It's almost 3,000 meters tall, and it's never extremely difficult technically, but it has a lot of technical climbing on it. So traditionally, you know, I think the first ascent was over 9 days, and the second ascent similar, you know, so it's had this big aura around it for a long time. And but of course, you know, as time passes, equipment has changed so much, weather forecasting has gotten better, you know, climbing changes so much over time. And I just basically realized, oh, this route is totally soloable and no one's done it. And to me, it seemed like a very obvious and really appealing objective. And actually, in a lot of ways, I think the Infinite Spur was a perfect solo objective for me. Partly because it fit very well my skill set and previous experience. I already had a lot of experience climbing in the Central Alaska Range. I already had a lot of experience doing very long single push climbs with no bivouac equipment. And also, I think the best soloing objectives are the ones where soloing provides you some advantage and not just disadvantage.
Speed, for instance.
Yes. So when you're soloing something that's hard enough that you have to rope solo it, it is so much slower and more laborious compared to climbing with a partner. So if I went to try to solo the east face of Cerro Torre, it would be way, way slower than climbing with a partner. But on the other hand, if it's easy enough that you can comfortably free solo, it's way easier and faster than climbing with a partner. And so, you know, I've done a lot of free soloing and a lot of rope soloing and a lot of solos that are a mix of the two. But for me, an objective where you can free solo the whole thing is definitely the more appealing solo objective. Mm. And the Infinite Spur is just easy enough technically that I was comfortable free soloing all of it, but it's has so much technical climbing and it's such a big route that no matter if you're solo or with a partner, it's still going to be a very serious big climb. And so I feel like on the Infinite Spur, if you have a high enough technical level that you know you can free solo it all, and if you have a high enough level of physical fitness that you know that you can climb up and down 3,000 meters of terrain and know that you're not going to get too tired and you can keep going with no bivouac gear, in some ways it became kind of just like the perfect objective for me to solo, where if I had done it with a partner, it definitely would have taken me more time and in a way been more difficult, like physically.
Your solo climbs, do you normally climb them roped up before you attempt them solo?
I wouldn't say normally, but it has been the case with a few that are like, especially some of my more difficult ones. And I think that kind of ties back a little bit to what you were saying, which is that, of course, if you know a climb already, it makes it much easier, at least mentally, than if you have never done it before. And so the Infinite Spur is a climb that I did with a partner before I soloed it. And same with Torrey Egger. And I'm sure there's some, Aguja Stanhart in Patagonia, Fitzroy in Patagonia. And so any of those solos, if I didn't know the route at all, would have been more serious. But there's, there's pros and cons. Basically, for the Infinite Spur, for instance, if I had not climbed it before, I would not have been comfortable. I wouldn't have had the confidence to know that I could definitely free solo all of it. So if I went up on the Infinite Spur by myself without knowing the route, I would have taken probably at least 80 meters of rope, more likely 120 meters of rope because it's a 3,000 meter route. And I would have taken a rack of gear. And then with that much weight, you're not going to manage to do it as a day climb anymore. So then I would have taken a sleeping bag and a thermarest and a tent and a stove. And then your backpack's heavy enough that you for sure are gonna have to start belaying some pitches. And so these things are all exponential. And if I had soloed the Infinite Spur without knowing the route previously, I'm guessing that it would have been a 4 or 5 day climb. And what I did instead is I climbed the route with a partner and then soloed it several days later in 12 and a half hours. So it's 12 and a half hours versus 5 days. It's a humongous difference. And to me, both of those would be similar accomplishments. You know, climbing the Infinite Spur solo and on site in 5 days, climbing the Infinite Spur solo in 12 and a half hours, but already knowing the route. The two accomplishments are kind of equivalently difficult in my mind, but one is more a feat of athleticism and one is more a feat of adventure. But in reality, if you're by yourself on a 3,000 meter technical route in an extremely cold Alaskan environment, it's going to be a humongous adventure no matter what. Mm. And that's how it turned out. Also,
which we're going to touch on a little bit later on, but now pivoting back, and this is a topic I would like to cover. Much of the game is accepting failure. And for example, on one of the Alaska trips you made with the greatest chances of success was back in 2011 with a Norwegian friend, Nils Nilsson. You had spent all spring training together in Chamonix. You were in super good fitness and had a ton of motivation. And despite all this, and despite some very good attempts after 41 days in the range, you'd been denied any success by brutally bad luck with weather and conditions. In 2012, you put even more time, spending a whopping 55 days on the Kahiltna Glacier with no success. What I'm wondering here is, how have you managed to handle failures and disappointments over the time?
I think if you are not turning around and failing on climbs pretty often, then it either means that you're pushing too hard and you're going to wind up killing yourself before too long, or it means you're not attempting things that are that difficult for you. So if you're trying to do things that are difficult for you, and if you have a good sense of self-preservation, it's just normal in mountaineering that you're going to turn around a lot of the time. On big, serious objectives, you'll probably turn around at least as often as you succeed. And I think realistically, it's usually more often. So that's just part of mountaineering. And I've been climbing mountains since I was really young, and I've climbed mountains a ton. So having to turn around is just something I've been used to for an extremely long time. And I guess I don't really like take it too hard. That's just how it goes sometimes. And
but with enough desirable objective, how many times would you attempt?
I guess depends on how appealing of an objective it is, but hypothetically, lots. Yeah. I mean, I don't know what is the largest number of times that I've attempted a single climbing objective, except for sport climbing, which is
dozens,
probably a lot
more.
But for a big alpine climb, no, it's definitely less than dozens, but maybe three or four, something like that.
Yeah. How is the elation, how's the sentiment after finally concluding such a project after so many attempts? Is that bigger of a feeling and celebration than finishing it at the first attempt?
I think that's true. Yeah, I think if something takes you a lot of tries to succeed on, then, you know, that's at least some sort of indication that it's something that's very challenging for you. And I think there's a pretty strong correlation for how challenging something is and how rewarding it feels to succeed on it.
Somehow, your climbs, could they be an inspirational source, you think, for people not giving up and giving in too easy?
Maybe. I mean, I think the reality is the climbing I do might be inspiring to people who have an intricate understanding of mountaineering, but to people who don't, you know, I'm just some guy who's off climbing a mountain. It doesn't really mean anything.
Hopefully after this podcast would change that.
Yeah, but I definitely think that what you're saying has some truth to it. And, you know, I actually was thinking about this recently in kind of the context of the some larger kind of political and historical concepts. I think this will get a bit off topic, but I think historically there are kind of empires that build up and kind of achieve greatness in terms of like a nation. And then when these nations achieve greatness and kind of recognize how great they are, then they inevitably start getting lazy and lose that greatness.
And collapse eventually.
Yeah. And, you know, I think
I see you read Jared Diamond.
Well, I have not read his book Collapse, but I have read Guns, Germs, and Steel.
Collapse is a good essential read.
Okay.
Highly recommend it.
But, you know, when I look at the U.S., for instance, at the end of World War II, the U.S. was kind of like a shining example of greatness. But the kind of economic consequences of the U.S. kind of winning World War II meant that for the next several decades, the U.S. could kind of profit off of cheap resources and labor from all other parts of the world. And people in the U.S. just kind of got used to having a really good life without really having to work that hard. And now that, you know, so much of the developing world is catching up and, you know, doesn't necessarily want to do America's dirty work for tiny wages, and wealth disparity on a global scale has been decreasing, I think Americans, you know, have come to expect a really high quality of life without really having to work hard. And it's a harsh reality when that starts to not be the case anymore. And for like a different example, you have China, which in 1950 was still a very third world country, and now is, you know, arguably the most innovative, developed, progressive country in the world that industrially, economically is just leading the way. And I think the people there are super hardworking because, you know, for maybe a couple centuries, China hasn't been at the forefront of human society, and now they have this motivation to achieve greatness. Anyways, this is super off topic.
But it's relevant. It's relevant because I have a couple of follow-up questions. My reaction on this is that the epiphany and the takeaway is never get lazy.
Well, I mean,
is that how we should translate it?
I'm lazy in all sorts of ways. You know, you pick your battles. And I think it's hard to tell anyone. In fact, I would say that I'm uncomfortable telling people what to do as a general rule. But I do think that most people, if they find something that they like enough that they put a lot of effort into it, it usually enriches their life a lot. Whether it is, you know, making paper mache or playing chess or climbing mountains, whatever.
Eventually they will master it. And it's a fantastic feeling of actually being very good at something.
Yeah, and well, or just putting a lot of effort into anything. If I think anyone who can find something that they enjoy enough that they actually do feel motivated to try really hard at it, I think they usually find that their life is really enriched by that experience. And yeah, it could be anything from learning the piano to, you know, whatever. Mm. But I do think for people who don't feel like they have that in their life, it's worth trying tons of different things until you find something that that captures you, that you actually want to try hard at. You're not forcing yourself to try hard at it because someone told you that you should have a hobby and try hard at something, but you actually want to.
And perhaps not always focusing so badly and hard on the actual goal, but enjoying the journey.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that is super important in climbing as well. You know, I see particularly in rock climbing, like high-end sport climbing, sometimes people get so focused on trying to climb a certain grade that I think they, to some degree, stop enjoying the experience because unless they're achieving that goal, they're just like, oh, I'm not doing it, I suck. But I think having that mentality actually makes it more difficult to achieve that goal. You know, whereas if instead you just enjoy the climbing and make sure to always keep the climbing experience enjoyable, then you actually try way harder than if you're just focused on the goal.
Let's go back to Infinite Spur. Despite your success on the Infinite Spur, the down climb was offering most of the challenge. It was starting snowing hard. Visibility was reduced to zero. Avalanche conditions were the sketchiest you ever seen in 20 years of skiing and mountaineering. And you triggered at least 30 slabs avalanches during your descent. You were also alone. And I'm wondering, what is going around in your head at this time?
What was going on in my head was mostly just being extremely cognizant of the situation I was in and how serious it was, and just trying to be as logical as possible about making the best possible decisions to survive that situation. And, you know, I had certainly some awareness in the back of my mind of like, oh shit, this is like very serious and I might not make it through this. But, you know, I guess I know rationally that getting emotional about being in such a scary situation is not going to help you. And so I think for that whole descent, which was, you know, something like 2 days long, 90% of all my thoughts were just very logical, rational thoughts about trying to maximize every chance I had to get down safely. And I think, you know, kind of thinking about the more existential questions of if your life is going to continue and, you know, the people you love and all that, I just, you know, didn't really let into my mind much because I thought it was, I just had to focus on being productive in ways to maximize my chances of surviving.
Do you have certain techniques that keeps your head calm and vigilant at desperate times?
I wouldn't say so. And so maybe that's kind of a natural trait of mine. I'm not sure. I guess I have seen some instances of people kind of freaking out in serious situations and not thinking very clearly, which of course is not helpful in those situations. But most of the time, you know, when I've been in really serious situations with partners, I think they've been just as clear-headed as I am about, like, okay, what do we need to do? How should we do this? You know, what are our best decisions, our best options? And maybe that's just that the people who tend to reach high levels in mountaineering and excel in mountaineering are people who tend to have an ability to stay clear-headed in serious situations.
You say that you were proud of having made the first solo ascent of the Infinite Spur, and you're proud of having managed to climb the route quickly, but in the end, wasn't worth it, you say, in the terms of all the risk you were exposed to. This ability to gauge and reflect on a climb, being self-critical, how has that helped your climbing career, you think?
Well, I guess maybe, I mean, in that instance, reflecting on that climb and realizing that even though I'm very proud of it, the amount of risk that was involved in hindsight was too large to justify that climb. I wouldn't say that that reflection really helps my career as a climber, but helps my longevity as an alive climber.
True.
But I guess that just general reflection after an ascent or after an attempt is one of the most key processes to becoming a better climber. Because, you know, like we were saying, climbing mountains is both a physical activity and a mental activity. And I actually think that my strengths as a climber are more mental than physical. And every time you come down from a successful climb or an attempted climb, there are things to be learned, tons of things, you know, whether it's...
Do you sit down on your desk and write down and analyze all the climbs?
No, that wouldn't necessarily be a bad idea, but I've never done anything like that. But just in my head, you know, thinking like, okay, maybe I brought more cams than were necessary, or I should have brought more pitons, or bivouacking there wasn't such a good idea because it doesn't get the sun early in the morning, or, you know, oh, in hindsight, you know, I bet if you took out the bivy gear, you could just do this climb in one long day, or, you know, there can be so many things to take away from a climb or an attempt, but that is part of the learning process of becoming better. And, you know, at this point in time, I would say that probably my biggest asset as an alpine climber is the fact that over the last 20 years, I've done a humongous volume of alpine climbing, more than almost anyone I know, I think, maybe more than anyone I know.
When will we expect you write your book?
Maybe someday when I have more time. But my point is that all of that experience gives you an advantage in terms of having the most the most education about how to best go about things and how to do things safely. And
Alex Holland, you did the Torah Traverse in less than 30% of the time of the previous fastest ascent. And I think that was there's only been one ascent
previously.
Yeah.
Which I was on. Yeah.
Yeah. So you bet that with 30%. So for you, it wasn't so shocking that you were able to solo the Infinite Spur in 50% of the time of the long-standing speed record. We covered this a little bit earlier, that solo climbing becomes so much faster than everything else because you carry so little gear and you're not roped up and you don't need to belay. What's the next thing? How can we speed up even more? Is that due to more athleticism?
You mean in kind of speed ascents?
Exactly.
Uh-huh. Because, of course, you know, even though most people know I kind of like, you know, quote unquote, speed climbing, you know, it's only one part of climbing and it's only one part of my climbing. Yeah, obviously having a higher fitness level allows you to climb faster. But
is that something you're focusing on?
Well, I wouldn't really say so. Maybe at certain times when I have a certain planned objective for which cardiovascular fitness would make a big difference, then I spend more time trying to be really fit in that regard. But it just depends on the climbing objective. And it really depends on how technical the climbing objective is, because let's see. Basically, if it's a very non-technical objective, like say the normal route on Mont Blanc, the reason that Kilian Jornet has the speed record and the reason that it's incredibly fast is because he's just so fit cardiovascularly. But if you get to something more technical, like say the Heckmair route on the north face of the Eiger, the reason that Uli Steck has that speed record is partly because he's very fit cardiovascularly, but mostly because he is an extremely good, or was an extremely good technical climber, and was also willing to, you know, take a pretty big risk. And then when you get more technical, when it comes to something like free rider on El Capitan, you know, Alex Honnold now has the speed record on free rider, and that really didn't have anything to do with cardiovascular fitness. It just had to do with being such a good technical climber that you can free solo everything. So with my speed record on the Infinite Spur, I'd say that that was kind of 50-50, like 50% dependent upon being very fit and very well acclimatized at that moment, but just as much dependent upon having a high enough technical climbing ability to be able to free solo everything. Because I could have been drastically more fit, like I could have been as fit as Kilian Jornet, but if I didn't have a high enough technical level to comfortably free solo all of it, then even with Kilian's fitness, I would have been slower. So it just depends on the objective. Because as soon as you have, you know, a 60-meter rope and a set of cams and four ice screws and a bunch of runners, then that makes a huge difference, you know. If I go and climb the normal route on Mont Blanc with someone way more fit than me, but they have a 20-kilo backpack and I have none, it doesn't matter that they're more fit, I'll still go faster, you know. So it just depends on the objective. But cardiovascular fitness is, for some objectives, a huge part of it, and for other objectives, a much smaller part of it.
Have you ever felt that hard solo climbs been almost addictive?
I mean, I think it all depends on how addictive is defined. But I could certainly, yeah, I think it's certainly fair to describe it that way.
In a healthy way.
Yeah. I mean, in a healthy way, as long as you don't screw up and kill yourself.
For those who just sworn off soloing as something intrepidly and laughing at death, how would you convey the elation of these moments to agnostics of the soloing art who doesn't understand the soloing art?
Well, I guess for me, the basic reasons why I like to climb difficult mountains and the basic reasons I sometimes like to solo them are the same. And soloing is kind of a more extreme slash more intense version, but it's still the same basic reasons. And I would say that it's for the challenge and it's for the kind of intensity that it brings to your life for that period of time. And I think that modern life, if you live in a developed country and if, you know, you don't have some unlucky circumstances, is relatively easy. And I don't mean that life is easy. Obviously, there are all sorts of hardships, you know, from financially to emotionally that people face all the time. But I mean that we don't normally wake up in the morning wondering if we will survive until the evening, worrying, you
know.
Would
that help?
Well, no, no. My point is that I think 50,000 years ago, when all humans were nomadic hunter-gatherers, constantly, you know, trying to find the next woolly mammoth, trying not to get eaten by a saber-toothed tiger, constantly on the brink of starvation, I imagine that that was, to a large degree, an intense existence. And I think modern life doesn't have that same intensity. And I think going and climbing difficult mountains, and to an even greater degree, climbing them by yourself, puts you in these very serious situations where your survival is dependent upon you making really good decisions, and it's dependent upon your physical preparedness. And, you know, it's not like most sports where if you're having a bad day, you can just say, ah, okay, I'm not feeling it today, I'm just going to stop. You know, when you're in the middle of a really serious alpine climb and you realize that it's not going well, even just to get home and survive requires a lot of physical effort and a lot of mental effort. And so climbing mountains and soloing them particularly just puts you in these intense situations and gives your life this intensity that I think in modern life we don't normally experience. And even though it seems totally absurd to intentionally put yourself or kind of consciously put yourself in these intense and very stressful situations, I think there's, at least for me, and I think for a lot of people, some sort of human nature buried deep inside from our evolutionary history that kind of thrives on that intensity.
You made a habit of documenting your solo climbs very well, since the alpine climbing world seems prone with incredulity these days, and not the gentleman agreement that was practiced before Photoshop. You value honesty, so you take great measures in making sure your climbs has solid evidence. What measures do you take to document these climbs? I mean, you take a lot of photographs. Do you use this GPS or positioning or something? How is your methodology in keeping track of your climbs?
Pretty much just taking photos. I've experimented a little bit with GPS tracking, but I don't really know how relevant it is, because my impression is that anyone with good computer skills could probably just create a fake GPS track really easily. But I haven't really done GPS tracking much more, just because it uses up a lot of battery life, and I don't like to have to carry extra trinkets with me. I just try and take a lot of photographs, which, you know, mostly it's just because I really like taking nice photos, and I've always been kind of into photography. But yeah, if you're climbing by yourself, I think it's a good idea to show that you were there. Unfortunately, I think that's pretty necessary. There have been plenty of examples historically of people saying that they climbed something and it turned out to very clearly be a lie. And I wish that weren't the case, but it is. And so I think it's kind of only logical that if you go and you say that you soloed some really hard route and you bring back no photos, I think it's logical that people might not believe you. Mm-hmm. And I definitely dread the day that I accomplish some awesome solo and my camera breaks and then I have nothing to show for it, because I think it's inevitable that in that sort of situation, some people would say that they don't believe it. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I don't blame people, because there have been so many famous examples of climbers lying about things. Mm-hmm. I try and take lots of photos, so it clearly shows that I did climb a certain route, you know, but in terms of solo speed records, like my solo times on the Infinite Spur or the North Buttress of Bagaya, that is basically taken, you know, on my word. I guess it would actually be pretty hard to fake it, because my photos show like a clear progression of one day. And if I had spent more than one day on the route, then it would start to be very obvious that, oh, lower on the route, it was bright sunshine and now it's dark again, you know, stuff like that. You know, with my solo of the Infinite Spur, if I had wanted to lie and say that I did it in 10 hours instead of 12 and a half, it would be hard for someone to, you know,
scrutinize that.
Yeah. I mean, and all my photos have a timestamp on them, which I always take a photo at the base of the route and on the summit, because not only for, you know, evidence, but just for my own knowledge, because that's how I time those things. I don't have a watch. I just take a picture crossing the Schrund and I take a picture right when I arrived at the summit. And then when I get down to base camp, I look at the times on the two, and that's how I know how long I took. But just like with GPS tracks, I'm sure that someone who's really computer savvy can just modify the timestamps on the photos. Mm-hmm. So, you know, for me, the speed climbing thing is only one part of my climbing, and it's not a large part of my climbing. And some of the speed climbing I do is with partners anyways. And, you know, if it's two people, for both people to get together and say like, okay, let's lie and say we did it this fast, that seems like pretty improbable. But if my climbing were focused purely on speed, like the type of stuff Kilian Jornet does, then, you know, it would start to be tricky, because then you're pretty reliant on either having people, you know, at certain points along the way to verify when you got there, or a GPS track, if that actually does make for solid evidence. I have no idea. But it seems like if you, the main thing of someone's climbing is doing speed records of kind of normal routes, then, you know, proving that is probably a tricky thing, I would imagine. Mm. And I would guess that in that sub-world of climbing, you know, people breaking the records on the normal route on Aconcagua and Kilimanjaro and whatnot, I would guess that there probably is, you know, lots of questions of like, well, how did this person time their ascent, and what evidence is there, and witnesses and stuff like that. You know, there was a famous case in Seattle, actually, where a guy who, it turned out, had all sorts of mental issues, claimed a new speed record on Tahoma, Mount Rainier, and it was a really fast time, and it was reported all over the Seattle Times and all this stuff, and everyone was really amazed. And it took some time for people to realize that it was complete it was just 100% lie. And there was no witnesses, no GPS track, nothing. And yeah, unfortunately, that's a part of the history of climbing.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but the high Himalayas never been in your arena. You've been there a couple of times.
Yeah, more than a couple, actually. I've been to Pakistan, I think, 5 times, to India once, and Nepal twice. So a fair amount. But I have quite little to show for it in terms of climbing accomplishments. And I'd say probably the best is a friend and I did the first ascent of a 6,000-meter peak in Pakistan via a very technical route with probably like M5 mixed climbing and 510 rock climbing and sustained the whole way. That's probably been my best success in the greater Himalaya. But for, you know, something like 7 or 8 trips, that's not much. And I think a large part of that is because on a lot of those trips, I kind of bit off more than I could chew, in that before I started going much to Pakistan, I had already done some very high-level climbs in Alaska and Patagonia. And so you kind of expect that you will also do high-level climbs in a different place. But in reality, I think just as there's a learning curve with climbing mountains and gaining experience and learning how to improve, there's also a learning curve with a certain mountain range, because the tactics that will be the most efficient in the Karakoram are not necessarily the same as the tactics that will work the best in Alaska or in Patagonia. And my first trip to Pakistan was when I was 20 years old, and I tried to solo Nanga Parbat from the Rupal side, which is the much more difficult side. And prior to that, I had only been to 6,000 meters a couple times. So it was kind of, it would have been a big jump if I had succeeded. And my second trip to Pakistan was to try to climb.
How did it go?
I made it to 6.5. So I didn't make it very high. I actually think I would have made it noticeably higher if I had better timing with the weather. But in any case, my second trip to Pakistan, I went to try the southeast pillar of Oltar Sar in the Hunza region, which is a 3,000-meter route to a nearly 7,400-meter summit with sustained technical difficulties all the way to the top. And it's still unclimbed. It's, you know, one of these big prizes. And that was when I was, I think, 23, and my partner was the same age. And I mean, in hindsight, even though I had done, you know, climbs in Patagonia that are arguably on the same level as a first ascent of that route, it's a different mountain range, and it's different tactics, and it's different skills. And in hindsight, yeah, I definitely didn't have the experience at that time to have a good shot of succeeding on that route with a good safety margin. And yeah, so I think, yeah, one of the main reasons that I haven't had much success in the Himalaya is because I should have started out smaller. Yeah.
Could that still be an objective for the future?
The southeast pillar of Oltar?
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, yeah. I mean, there are a lot of very inspiring objectives in the Karakoram, I think. And you know, for the last decade, my climbing has mostly been focused on Patagonia and Alaska, which I've really enjoyed, and I'm really proud of a lot of the climbs I've done in those two places. But I do feel that I've spent a lot of time in those mountain ranges, and I do want to explore more in probably the greater Himalaya. And to me, the biggest downside to that is there's so much bureaucratic red tape involved in climbing anywhere in the greater Himalaya, whether it's Nepal or China or India or Pakistan. I think it's really a shame how complicated it is, because I don't think it needs to be that way, and I don't think it really benefits anyone that it is that way. But in any case, The mountains are incredible, especially in Pakistan, I think. And so, you know, I won't make too many predictions because I feel like I'm constantly reevaluating what sort of climbing objectives are most inspiring to me and where I want to put my energy. But I think it's at least likely that in the coming years, I'll spend more time going to places like Pakistan and Nepal.
And you have some opinions about 8,000 meter climbs. You had an experience yourself. You went to G2. It was a couple of years ago. We met at the Islamabad airport and we traveled together on a bus to Skardu. And you went to G2 and it wasn't quite the way you were anticipating 8,000 meter climbs. You were devastated. That's at least my interpretation of your story. What's going on?
I wouldn't say I was devastated, but it was a bit of a lackluster trip for me for a few reasons. I would say the biggest reason was that I had just recently started a relationship with Alyssa, my partner now. And, you know, in the early parts of a relationship with someone that you are really in love with, it's kind of hard being away for a long time. And I think that that definitely affected my mentality. And when I decided to come home, I was like, okay, well, I could try the summit next week, or I could go hang out with my girlfriend. And I was like, ah, screw it. So that was a big factor. Another factor was that for me, the whole motivation to go to G2 wasn't because I actually cared at all about climbing G2. It was because I have aspirations of climbing technically difficult routes on high 7,000 meter peaks. And so I figured that climbing an easy route on an 8,000er would be a good prerequisite to make sure that I felt comfortable and safe at that altitude, which is totally logical. And I still think that's a good idea. But what it meant is that the whole expedition was based around an objective that I didn't actually care about much. So my motivation to succeed on it was a lot lower than for an objective that I'm really inspired by. And yeah, lastly, I was definitely a bit dismayed by the whole 8,000 meter scene. You know, I think that there are tons of different types of climbing. You know, climbing today is an extremely varied activity. And if you look at indoor competition bouldering and 8,000 meter climbing, you know, they both are climbing, but they're about as similar as American football and ping pong, you know? And so they're completely different activities. And I think that every kind of climbing is cool and has people doing very impressive things, very inspiring things. So, you know, I often hear people say like, oh, aid climbing stupid, or 8,000 meter peaks are stupid, or bouldering stupid. And I think all those comments are stupid. Every type of climbing is cool, in my opinion. And there are a lot of people who focus on 8,000 meter climbing who I think are really awesome and who I really respect. But what I realized on that trip is that a lot of the other people who go to 8,000 meter peaks are, I guess, the kind of peak bagger tourists who have somehow decided that, you know, ticking mountain A, B, or C is what they want to do, but they never really learned anything about climbing mountains before going there. In general, the level of skill and experience in the people who were at G2 base camp was shockingly low, like crazy low. And the amount of risk that people were taking was crazy high. I basically got the impression that a lot of the people who go to 8,000 meter peaks, they actually do have the mentality that the media portrays them as having of just like summit or death. It doesn't matter. This is supposed to be a life or death, near miss kind of situation. And
Which sounds like a very sad portrait of the sport in general, because it saturates the entire sport. It also affects all other types of climbing, in my opinion.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it certainly affects the general public's perception of what climbing is. But so, for an example, on G2, you know, I was trying to do it as a day climb from base camp, and I never ended up making a legitimate attempt. I went one time up to 7.5 and came back down. But 7.5 is where the high camp is on G2. I think that's right, if I'm remembering correctly. And from there to the summit is 500 meters of elevation gain. And the terrain is basically completely non-technical. It's just walking in the snow. And for that 500 meters up and down, some of the people who successfully climbed G2 that year took nearly 24 hours to do 500 meters up and down of completely non-technical terrain. And I mean, what I realized is that these people were doing, you know, exactly what you hear stories about, of taking one step and then stopping for 30 seconds to gasp, and then taking one step and then stopping for 30 seconds to gasp, and then laying down in the snow, and then, you know, doing that sort of thing. And to me, that is crazy, because if you are that destroyed physically, you have no safety margin. You know, for me, if I were tired enough to be going even remotely as slow as that, that would be an extremely strong indication that I should be descending. And to me, the fact that people keep going up when they can barely walk is just ludicrous. And it's just a completely different mentality from like the climbers that I'm used to interacting with and seeing in the mountains.
Will you go back to 8,000 meter after this scene?
I might at some point. I mean, there's no reason why that scene really needs to bother me so much, as long as, you know, I can steer clear of the fixed ropes and whatnot. It was more just a bit of a shock to observe. I wouldn't say that I have a lot of interest in any of the 8,000 meter peaks. The only 8,000 meter peak that, when I see a photo of it, I say that's a badass mountain, is K2. But without any doubt, a mountain like Gasherbrum 4, which is just below 8,000 meters, is drastically more appealing to me than any of the 8,000 meter peaks are.
So what do you think is the future of hard soloing?
I guess I think, you know, I think people often ask this sort of question about like, oh, where is alpinism going? And I think, what's the future of sport climbing? And unfortunately, even though it's kind of a boring response, I think the answer to all those questions is it's a slow progression, just like it has been for the last 100 years, you know? I mean, I guess things change more quickly at some times than others, but since the 1970s till now, the hard solos that people have accomplished in the mountains have, you know, been progressively a little bit faster, progressively a little bit more technically difficult. But, you know, it's a slow progression, I think, in all of these things. You know, if you think about Reinhold Messner soloing the north face of Les Droites sometime in the late 70s, I believe. That would be a pretty easy solo today, but still it's not like the soloing done today is unrecognizable from that. It's just that it's slightly bigger, slightly harder, you know, and it'll continue in the same direction. People will solo things that are a little bit more technically demanding, a little bit more sustained, maybe at a little bit higher altitudes, and yeah, it's a boring response, but I think that's the reality.
So what is the, according to you, the most impressive solo sense in the 21st century?
If Uli Steck soloed the south face of Annapurna, that would probably be the most impressive. And unfortunately, we'll never know if he did or not. So let's see. We're talking about the last 20 years.
Or we could rephrase it. We could say, which solar sensor of the 21st century has made greatest impact on you?
I guess part of the reason why I was hesitating with that response is because I want to be careful not to blow my own horn too much, but I think it's actually quite a small group of people who are even interested in hard alpine soloing. And so I do think that some of my solo ascents would be among that list of the most standout of the 21st century, like the Infinite Spur and the first solo ascent of Tor Eger. I'd say that the other ones that are most forefront in my mind are two solo ascents that Marc-André Leclerc did, also in Patagonia, one of the corkscrew route on Cerro Torre and one of the east pillar of Tor Eger, the year after I soloed it. And both of those are solo ascents that I thought were extremely impressive. And I guess I would also say had a big impact on me because Marc-André was a climbing partner of mine, but and we were friends, but I also think we had a little bit of like a friendly rivalry going on for this small niche of hard solo alpine climbing. And soloing Tor Eger is something that I had been planning and scheming for a bunch of years. And I think Marc-André soloing the corkscrew route on Cerro Torre was partially responsible for me finally going and doing the first solo ascent of Tor Eger, because for a long time I felt like I was the only person who might do it. And then I suddenly realized that, like, oh, there's someone else who might do this also. And so it probably gave me that last little extra kick of motivation to go and make it happen. Mm. And I know that the inverse is true as well, that when I went and did the first solo ascent of Tor Eger, that gave Marc-André an extra boost of motivation to go and solo the East Pillar later on.
So who is gonna boost you now, you think?
I don't know. That's a good question. Unfortunately, I'd say that, you know, a decently large number of the very high-level alpine climbers of the last 10 years are not alive right now.
Is that something you reflect upon?
Yeah, it is a lot. And actually, it could kind of tie into something that I've been thinking about a lot in the last couple years, and that at some point I think I want to write an article about, which I think I would call the article something like The Problem with Alpine Climbing. This is a bit of a tangent. It'll get a little bit long, but basically, if you are really into sport climbing, then you basically just have to get stronger and stronger and stronger to climb harder and harder routes. And there's no way around that. But in alpine climbing and also free soloing and big wall speed climbing, there is this conundrum, which is that if you want to achieve a really difficult objective, if you take a bunch of shortcuts on safety, you can achieve that objective much more easily. Basically, in alpine climbing and free soloing and big wall speed climbing and other types of climbing like that, there's always this conundrum that there's a temptation to lower your safety margin to achieve your goals, because free soloing is way easier than rope soloing. So if you just free solo at a higher level, you can climb much more easily. And you know, taking one rope is easier than taking two, and then you can climb more easily because you have less weight, but then you are maybe committed to descending the other side of the mountain. There's a million examples. Placing less protection takes less energy and less time, et cetera, et cetera. There's always something to be gained by sacrificing safety in alpine climbing. And so it's very important that, you know, as you pursue your goals and goals that you care about so much and are so motivated to try to succeed on, that you don't take too many shortcuts on safety. And I think, you know how I was saying it's human nature to be a little bit competitive, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Where there is a big problem is if people get so wrapped up in trying to accomplish something awesome that they start taking all these shortcuts on safety to achieve those goals, and then pretty soon end up not coming home from the mountains. And I think this is extremely common. And
is that a tendency?
I have no idea if it's getting bigger. I suspect it's kind of always been that way. I think a lot of people want to achieve really difficult things so much, and it's so much easier to achieve those things if you take these shortcuts on safety, that I think a lot of people take really big risk. And I think that's the main reason why so many top alpine climbers have died in the last 10 years.
We don't want to spoil your article and your summary,
yeah.
But what's the remedy?
The remedy is that you have to not let your dreams cloud your desire for self-preservation. So, you know, basically if you die, then that's like the ultimate way of losing, you know? And no climbing success is worth that outcome.
Here's the impossible question then. 80 years of yadi 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 or 40 years of full-on full volume?
You mean in one individual's life as a climber?
Uh-huh. What would you choose?
Probably the latter. I mean, 80 years, there I think are very few examples of people who have climbing careers that long. Fred Becky is probably the most obvious example. If I were to pick one, I would probably pick the 40 years of high intensity and then something different. But
what are you going to do then?
Who knows?
There's no plan.
I mean, I could easily imagine at some point in my life losing interest in hard alpine climbing. I can very easily imagine that. I think I could easily imagine at some point saying I'm done with hard alpine climbing, but still doing a lot of ski touring and sport climbing. You know, those are just pure type one fun, whereas alpine climbing is more like this very difficult and intense quest that is a lot more stressful. There's a lot of things to do in life, and I'm not going to try and predict things too much. I hope to have another decade of hard alpine climbing because I still have lots of dreams and still feel really motivated. Who knows? With Alyssa, we definitely have conversations about if we want to have kids at some point. And for me, I basically already knew when I was 18 years old that I do not want to be obsessed with hard alpine climbing and have kids at the same time. To me, it's not a good equation. And I just saw enough examples growing up of people who were trying to make that balance work. And for me, I think it would be too much to try and balance at once.
So if you only could climb one last mountain or one route for the rest of your life, only one left.
If I had an answer right off the tip of my tongue, that would be great. Because for a lot of my life, when I was 12 years old, I decided that all I wanted to do more than anything else was to climb Cerro Torre. And then I eventually succeeded in that. And by now I've climbed Cerro Torre several times. And since then, I haven't had such a clear, focused, specific goal that's always in the back of my mind, which I would like to have because I think that's a very motivating thing. But if I were to pick one mountain offhand that would be awesome to climb, I would probably say Gasherbrum 4. I just think it's like such an awesome mountain. And it's,
new route?
Maybe, maybe not. But I guess in general, I think mountains that are really difficult to climb by any route are the most appealing. You know, that's why things like Cerro Torre are so cool, because there's no easy way up them. And, you know, Gasherbrum 4 isn't as steep as Cerro Torre, obviously, but still very clearly, you know, even the easiest route on Gasherbrum 4, if you climb it in alpine style, is a very major achievement. And, yeah, I'm not sure if I'll ever actually go attempt that, because I kind of go back and forth about to what degree I'm interested in kind of extreme high altitude. And a lot of the time I think I'm not so interested in extreme high altitude, but yeah, it's just a mountain that visually is stunning, and knowing that getting up it is so difficult on any side, I think is very appealing.
If you could relive one moment in your life, which one would that be?
I'm not sure, but it probably wouldn't be a moment from a climb. It would probably be
perfect.
Something from
your
my
human.
Youth.
Congratulations.
You know, like something like, you know, losing my virginity or taking mushrooms for the first time or something like that.
I like those answers. Any last words you'd like to share with us?
No, I don't think so. But thanks, Frederick. That was good.
It's been an absolute pleasure having you on this podcast, Colin. Thank you sincerely for your time and contribution. So if people want to find out more about you and your whereabouts and perhaps your next expeditions or climbs, where should they turn to?
Well, I have a blog, which is just my name, .com, colinhaley.com. But I really only update that after a big kind of expedition type trip, which is maybe a few times a year. And otherwise, from kind of more day-to-day climbing activities, I make Instagram posts, which is, yeah, basically my name with a one after it.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.